All right, let's talk about high level what we're doing this evening. We're going to start off with just kind of some important information about 100 devs, some big things that are happening right now are going to be happening. This evening, we're going to be talking through like, what the heck is this terminal thing we keep hearing about? What is Git? The basics of Git. What is GitHub? The basics of how to use GitHub in more of a professional context, adding a little bit of process, a little extra sauce tonight into the mix that's going to help us. Tonight, we are going to be doing an introduction from zero to hero. So if you have no idea what the terminal is, you have no idea what the command line interface is, you have no idea what Git or GitHub even is, I got you. So before we jump into Git, we got to understand what this thing is called the terminal. I have this lovely program open over here on the right-hand side that you can see. That is my terminal. There are so many weird terms that are thrown at us as we're trying to learn this stuff. You're gonna see terminal, bash, git bash, Unix, shell, CLI, CMD. And I swear I have not made up any of those. These are all real things, folks. So when I talk about this terminal, all I'm really mean is a place where we can type commands that cause actions. All right, let's talk about some basic commands. One really important command to start off with is pwd, print working directory. And so once I have my terminal open, I can go ahead and just start typing these commands or the utilities that I want to use. It'll show you exactly where I am on my computer. The full working directory. You can see that I'm in my class 71, 100 devs folder, my stream folder, my desktop, my name of my computer, my users folder. We're going to talk about how to get the terminal running on your machine in a little bit. Another really popular command is make dir, which is going to make a directory or make a folder. And so let me show you something pretty cool. I'm going to do make dir, and I'm going to create a folder called example. And when I do that and I hit enter, you'll notice that I have created an example folder here in my GUI. Make dir is a command inside of the command line that I can use to create a folder. So if you're used to using a GUI, you would used to be doing something like this, like right click, new folder. Ugh. Like who wants to do that? Now we can be lead coders and make dir example to create a folder. We can also change directories. So we can move between the different folders using the command line. So I created this example folder, but we can see that I'm still in my class 71 folder. So I want to go into the folder that I just created. So I'm going to do CD and then the name of the folder. And the cool thing is you don't have to type out the entire name. I'm going to use tab to help the autocomplete. I did CD, which is short for change directory. And I'm going to change into the example directory. So I hit enter. And you can see now that I am in the example folder. Now, another thing we can do is if I wanted to go back up to my class 71 folder, I can do change directory dot dot. Change directory dot dot. You can see I went back up to the class 71 folder. If we were trying to link to our CSS, you might have seen like dot dot. So these dot dots show up in our paths, in our code, but they're also showing up here in the command line. Now, another command that we're gonna see often is the tilde. And this is gonna take us all the way back to our home folder. So CD, tilde, typically the tilde key is at the top left above your tab. So if you're like deep in the mess and you don't wanna do CD all the way back or do some other shortcuts, you can go all the way back to your folder and then we can start working our way back up. So there's a couple commands that I could figure out if I wanna start working my way back up. One of them real quick is my ls just to see where I'm at. And I'm gonna CD into my desktop. I'm gonna CD into my stream folder. I'm going to CD into my 100 devs folder. I am going to CD into my class 71. I could do CD all in each level. So actually, let me show you that. So I could do CD stream, right? And that'll take me into my stream folder, but I can also do it as like one string as well. So CD 100 devs, CD class, I'm just going to keep saying CD class 71. And there we go. So now I've CD'd all the way to my class 71 folder. So we can do one jump or we can do multiple jumps at a time. I still want to go into my example folder so I can do CD example. There we go. We have the ability to touch, which is to create a file. I'm inside my example folder. I can do touch index.html. And the cool thing is when I do that, I'm going to create an index.html inside that example folder. Just by doing the touch, I have created that index.html file. Now, the other wonderful thing is that I can also see all the files in a folder. And so often you kind of already saw me do it earlier. I was like, I know I'm at the home, but where am I at really? What were the folders that I, what were the things I could see? I wanted to make sure that I could jump into my desktop from the home directory. So you saw me do an ls command, just very kind of like natural, something I do all the time. And the ls command will show you all the files that are in a folder. What we'll notice is that certain commands have what we call flags. And flags are kind of like unlocking extra powers for those commands or utilities that you're using, right? And so these flags can help us do things that are slightly different. So if you do the ls-l, you'll see something a little bit different. That'll show you not only the file, but when it was created, right? So whenever you're creating files and folders, all this data is being stored about them, and the ls with the flag l can show you that information. And then the other flag that I use all the time is the dash la. Kind of the same thing. One of the cool things inside of my terminal, instead of retyping all the time, I just hit the up arrow and boom, it'll bring up the last command that you did. I brought up that last command. I'm going to add an A here as part of the flag. And when I do that, it's not only going to show me the files when they were created, but also it'll show me any hidden files that are there. So when we get to Git, Git's going to create a special little folder inside of our folder here that we can't see until we do the flag LA. So if you want to ever see all the files, all the things, even the hidden stuff, this flag gives you control. Some other really spicy commands, we should say, is the ability to remove files. So we can do rm, and I'm going to do an index.html, and watch what happens. You can look at my GUI. Look at my GUI. 3, 2, 1, boom, remove the file. It's gone, dunzo, vamos, it's out. We can remove folders from the command line, and we can even get really spicy and forcefully remove stuff. Like if you're gonna type this out, be careful. Don't hit enter until you've double, triple checked. This force command doesn't give up about anything. This is something that's really powerful, but also is very dangerous if used incorrectly. So rm-rf, and then I'm going to remove the example folder. One thing I always do is I hit tab to make it autocomplete the folder for me or the file for me, whatever I'm using. And as soon as I hit enter, it's gone. Whole folder gone. Doesn't matter. There could be protected stuff in there. It could be anything. It is dunzo. Disappeared, never coming back. This command has the ability to do amazing things in your workflow. It also has the ability to be used for evil. So be careful. The last command is this clear command, and you'll see me using it quite often. All clear does is make sure that your working terminal window, all the stuff that was there visible, boom, is now cleared, and you can keep writing your commands. So if you ever start to have a lot of junk in your terminal as you're trying to write commands in your command line, you can do clear and it'll get rid of it. If you want to access this terminal, there are some things you would need. And so I'm going to show you how to access the terminal. If you are on Mac or GNU Linux, you have an application called the terminal already installed on your operating system. So you would just open up your applications, find the terminal, and you're ready to rock and roll. If you're on Windows, I really recommend for today, Git Bash. What Git Bash will do is it makes all the commands that you're running on Windows the same as the ones that I'm seeing now. If you open up things like the command prompt, which is its own type of terminal, the commands that it runs and the utilities that it runs are slightly different. And so since they're slightly different, you might have a little bit more trouble following along what we're doing today. So I really recommend gitforwindows.org, which will help you install Git Bash. And that would make all the commands I've been using so far and all the commands we used for the rest of today would just work well for you. So if you know that you're going to be coding long term, this is something that you're getting into, you're hopefully trying to make it as a hobby or a career, then I really recommend the Windows subsystem for Linux on Windows, WSL. It's wonderful. I use it on my Windows machine. And if you're just trying to follow along for today, Git Bash. So we've talked about the command line, which is going to get us ready to talk about Git. So we're here tonight to learn how to use Git and then GitHub. And so we got to dive into what the heck is actually Git. let's say before you started using like Google Docs, right? And you had all the wonderful bits of the cloud. Let's say you were working on a Word doc before you had Microsoft 360 Office. What were you doing? You were saving a lot for sure. You were trying to back up that save some way, right? You were putting it on a thumb drive. And then what I really started doing, I started emailing them to myself. That way, if the computer borked, my thumb drive borked, right? If everything went to hell, I could just go to my email and get that version of my Word document. This was a very, very kind of early version for me of version control. And Git solves this problem, but when we're working with code, Git is a version control system. Git enables you to make snapshots. You can think of them as save points, like we saved our essay. You also just think of them as like save points, like in a video game, right? Git enables us to do this for our code. So we can take our snapshots by making a commit, just to introduce some lingo, just a fancy term for making a save point. And then the beautiful thing is we can roll back to those previous snapshots or those previous commit whenever we need to. If you're in this for a hobby or for a career, introduce GitHub into your workflow so that you can be more efficient and take the risks that make coding fun. So to use Git, you might have to install it. If you are on Windows and you use Git Bash, it comes baked into that Git Bash. You don't have to do any extra steps to install. Like I said, for today, you'll use Git Bash. For life, you'll use WSL. If you're on macOS, you can install Git. I like to use Homebrew for installing most of my stuff on macOS. Install Homebrew by opening up your terminal and pasting in this command, and then it would just be brew install Git. You might have to install Xcode or some other extra things on macOS, but this is how I would get it set up. Whenever you see the bling or the dollar sign, that's not something you type in to the terminal. It's just letting you know that anything that comes after this is what goes into your command line there. So you don't actually copy the bling or the dollar sign. You would grab everything after that. Once you have Git installed, there's two commands I would want you to run. One is this git config with your name, and then the other is your git config with your email. We want to go ahead and create a special place, a special folder to hold all of our snapshots. So you would be in your folder, you would do git init, and we can see that I initialized an empty git repository. And if I go up and do the command again, just hitting that up arrow, now we can see that after I did that git init command, now there's this new like hidden folder there inside when we do that command. And even though we can't see it in our like GUI folder structure, it's there, folks. And if we want to make our save point, our snapshot, we need to make a commit. And the cool thing is that over time, you'll have a bunch of snapshots in that Git repository, just like you could have a bunch of emails with all the different versions of your files in your inbox. My computer might crash, it might be stolen, I don't know. And so I don't want my snapshots to just be local. And so that's where the beauty of GitHub is introduced, because we can take these save points, these snapshots, and just like we were emailing to ourselves, we can push these snapshots to GitHub, making them go from local to remote, to where they're hosted by GitHub. For those that don't know, GitHub is now owned by Microsoft. So we can take our code, make our snapshots, and then eventually push those snapshots up to GitHub. They are now on the cloud, on Microsoft Azure's cloud. And if we ever need to go get those snapshots, we don't have to worry about them just being on our local machine. So what if you want to try adding a feature or something to your code base, but as it is right now, we might not want to try stuff, where you as a newer developer might want to try doing all these random things, something you found on Stack Overflow, something that you found in the docs if you're reading through documentation. This is something you might want to try. When you aren't using version control, each of these tries can be pretty pretty serious because you could break something. You could not be able to get back to the way your code was. One other really important thing that we can introduce that helps us kind of keep our code tidy. So we had this idea of branches. And what branches are going to enable us to do is to separate out the things that we're working on into different branches. And then we have the ability to switch to different branches should we ever want to. The cool thing is that the branches kind of create like these different workspaces where we could try something really risky. And if it doesn't work, we just switch back to our main branch. I want to show just the basic branches. The first thing you always kind of want to get into the habit of doing is just a nice git status. So right now I can see that I am on my main branch. I can see that there's nothing to commit. Like I haven't put any files on this staging area or anything like that. So it's clean. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new branch, git branch adventure. And so now I have this new branch called adventure. We're going to switch to that branch. Check out adventure. Beautiful. I want to try writing some code that I might not maybe think it'll make it to the main part of my project. I just want to go on an adventure and make sure I don't bork everything else that we've built so far. Those changes will be on this adventure branch. So let's go ahead and open up our code real quick. And let's go to the index.html. I can start typing out the word HTML and then hit tab to use Emmet to autocomplete. So now I just have the basics of my HTML file, nice little link tag here. And we can do our CSS/style.css, right? And maybe I wasn't sure how to do this, but I am in my adventure branch. So I don't have to really worry. So I made some changes. Let's add all of our changes. Git add dot, and let's commit our changes. Git commit. Let's go ahead. Now that we've committed our files, what we want to do is I want to switch to a different branch. We'll see that I have this lovely index.html file. And what I'm also going to do is let me just create a different HTML file to just make it a little bit more visual. A touch adventure.html. Let's make another commit. And I'm just going to say add it adventure git add dot. Let's just do a git status real quick. I'm going to clear and do a git status. Maybe I'll save this adventure for later on. Well, what I can do is I can go ahead and go back to my main by doing git checkout main. And keep an eye on the GUI real quick for me. That adventure.html went away. And let me show you something even cooler. Code dot. Let's open back up our VS Code here. There's nothing in the HTML file, but we can go back to our adventure branch if we want to. We have to go back. So I can do git checkout adventure. And look, the HTML adventure file came back and all the HTML changes I made come back too. We want to take the stuff that's snapshots that are saved on our computer and push them up to GitHub. The way that we're going to do a push is at first we need to create a new repository. And so if we go to GitHub, you'll see this little plus sign at the top right. I'm going to say new repository. If you have multiple accounts, you can change the account you want it to go into. I'm going to call this GitHub demo. I'm going to click create repository. So I go to settings, you go to pages, and then you say deploy from a branch, you choose your branch, you save, and then it just takes a minute or so. And you can see it's currently being built from the main branch. It'll take a minute or so. And then once it's done deploying, you can see that we now have a hosted website saying, thank you, Microsoft Azure, for sponsoring this wonderful class, this stream, this community time and time again. And so now not only do you have the ability to push your code to have backups, not only can you collaborate with other engineers, you now have the ability to host your stuff for free.